Thanks, Eric and Julie. We really appreciate the garden tour. Coming up next, we're going to be talking about water conservation. I'm joined by Christopher Charles with the conservation, the City of Austin Water Conservation Program. It's great to have you with us. Thanks for being on Central Texas Gardener.
Yeah, thanks for inviting me.
You know, we've had a generous year so far this year in terms of rainfall, but I bet interest is still very high in water conservation.
Yes, yes. Despite the recent rains, we're still not out of the drought. Mm-hmm. We're expecting, you know, to just continue the status quo with our watering restrictions here in Central Texas and, you know, and around Austin area.
Well, I think the drought has made us all aware that, you know, we should be doing more as homeowners and gardeners to hold on to the water that we have. And that's the emphasis of your program, right?
Yes. Basically, we're trying to inform the public that there's ways to do your landscape and conserve water at the same time.
Right. Well, holding on to what's coming off the roof is job one, it seems to me. And then anybody who's observed, you know, during one of our downpours, just the sheer volume of water that's just going down the curb and onto the street, really, sometimes as a gardener, it kind of makes you feel sick because you want to hold on to that stuff.
Right. We don't get those steady rains. You know, it's a lot or none at all.
Right.
So, yeah, the recent rains, we just got a lot of rain.
Mm-hmm. So slowing it down and holding on to it. So let's talk about the different techniques. Everybody has heard about barrels, but that's an effective first step, right?
Yeah, if you think about all the things that you can do as far as the rainwater coming off your roof, mm-hmm. then you definitely want to try to think about a rain barrel to start mm-hmm. off with.
Mm-hmm.
They come in many sizes. You can get like a 60-gallon at your home improvement store.
Right.
You can invest and get something like 2,000 gallons.
Sure.
It all depends on how much water you're going to want to be using on your lawn.
Right. Well, there's nothing like saving some of Mother Nature's water for a lot of our plants. They really do appreciate it. In addition to installing rain barrels or, you know, actual tanks, people can be doing more to hold on to the water as it comes out of the gutter. For example, they can use a terracing program so they live on hillsides, right?
Yeah. If they don't have a rain barrel, of course, you want to sort of direct your downspouts to the yard. And for people who have slopes in their yard, then you want them to basically slow down the flow, you know, and create terracing.
Mm-hmm.
This is usually people with slopes realize how fast the water can go down mm-hmm. their yard, and definitely terracing was probably one of the first options. I would say that most people with slopes don't realize that, and we're trying to inform them that that's
yeah.
one of the better techniques.
Well, it just makes sense. You're going from one flat surface where the water can kind of penetrate down a little bit before it spills over to the next one where, again, it can penetrate into the soil as opposed to just running down the surface,
mm-hmm.
right? That's a simple technique.
Right, and when you do lower the slope, you can definitely put in plant beds,
mm-hmm.
and you don't have to worry about the water washing them all out
mm-hmm.
because of the slope, yes.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you know, obviously on some of the steep slopes that you see in the hill country, I've seen people try some rather perilous gardening, you know, but slowing it down, improving the soil is really a key, right?
Right. Soil modification is another thing we preach at Austin Water. We have some rebates, actually, that involve getting compost or mulch. And with the compost, you want to blend that into your plant beds and even top dress your lawns
mm-hmm.
because that compost acts like a sponge and sort of absorbing the water when
mm-hmm.
it's there. What we offer is basically it's a small amount of cash, but we want you to purchased at least 2 cubic yards of
mm-hmm.
either compost or mulch, which is not just a couple of bags.
You're
talking
2 cubic yards.
Yeah,
it's a truckload.
With people that buy bags, it's 54 cubic feet,
mm-hmm.
and which ends up being 27 bags. So
yeah.
that's a big investment there.
Mm-hmm.
But the city's willing to help you out with some of that cost.
Okay, well, and it's a smart investment for the city as the city grows more demand on the water, which is a finite resource, as we've learned, right?
Mm-hmm.
Let's talk a little bit about rain gardens and that concept. This is directing water into particular areas of the garden and preparing that site to accept the water.
Right. For those people that have enough space, of course, if you have limited space, a rain garden might not be the best option. But for a lot of people here in Central Texas, they have quite a good sized yard. And to slow the flow, basically create a rain garden is one of the options to keep it on the water on site. Not only does this help out your lawn in conserving water because you'll be watering less, but it also helps watershed protection, and those type of entities that are worried about the storm drains and getting too full and stuff like that.
Sure.
So basically what we were looking at is something, good size little area where you can put in different plants that can not only live without water for times that we are not having rain, but can handle the torrential downpours that we get.
Right.
And you basically create a channel to the area of your yard. And the rain garden is it depends on how big you want the rain garden, but you basically have a nice little area where the water can collect. Now, this sounds kind of wrong because you never want water collecting around your house.
Right.
But
if you direct it well and to an appropriate place, that's what you're advocating.
That's exactly what we're advocating. And we don't want something that it's going to be sitting there for days and making mosquitoes either.
Sure.
We want to make sure that the soil can handle that.
Right. Hence the compost and mulch.
Yes.
Right.
A lot of people, to create the rain gardens, will create a slight berm, and the berm will stop the water. But we want to make sure that little berm that is created is not so large to where the water sort of backs into the house. We want to make sure that if we do get 4 or 5 inches of rain, that the water is going to go over that berm and into the street where we can handle it.
And you have suggestions for vegetable gardens like Oyas as well.
Yes. Right now, we are currently in stage 2 watering restrictions. It doesn't really matter which restrictions we're in. It seems like it's going to be a common practice to not be water every day. So what we recommend is that these Oyas, which are just clay pots that you can put into the ground, you can put into your raised beds as well, get installed. That way you can go out there, put water into these clay pots, and the water slowly leaches into the soil around it, and so therefore you're not having to water every day. The water slowly goes into the soil right where you need it.
So real briefly, tell me about wicking beds. This is another concept that I think people should be aware of.
Yeah, this is really popular with the vegetable gardeners. They realize that they can't be out there watering every day, especially with watering restrictions. So what they're doing is you're creating these raised planter beds or even sunken planter beds that involve getting the water to the roots. So what the way that works is basically a bed is created with a pond liner. So you want the water to be on the bottom of
right.
this bed. And then after the pond liner is set in, then gravel is set in there with some PVC pipes with one connection leading up past the soil area.
Mm-hmm.
And what people like this for is they can fill up the water. It stays in the bottom of this bed, and it wicks through the soil
right.
to their vegetables.
Right, and then the roots just draw it up. So it's a really smart way to go. You're putting the water down deep where it's not going to evaporate, which is what the problem with surface watering is, right?
Correct.
Right. Well, real briefly, there's one other little thing to think about, and this is a no-brainer, but so often people forget it, and that's hydrozoning, putting plants appropriately together, right?
Correct. There's so many people that don't understand plants, and not saying that everybody, I mean, basically when you go to a nursery, they'll tell you, oh, this is a very low drought-tolerant plant, very low water use plant, and then they'll not do the research on another plant,
right.
and they'll put them together, and one plant might not like all that sun.
Right, so, or all that water, and just be aware of putting like with like, exactly, right? Well, we're going to have to wrap it up on that note, I'm afraid, but I'm sure that you're a popular guy these days in terms of the garden club circuit, in terms of talking about all these different things. And I'm really glad the city's involved in getting us all aware about conserving our most precious resource. Thanks for being on the program.
Thank you.
All right, coming up next is Daphne.